Thank you, Representative Beta, for your work on this. I do note that we have Donna McNeilan, Professor and Co-Director of the Cooley Innocence Project, along with Professor Marla Mitchell, also from Cooley Innocence Project, your co-director, and Mr. Ken Winemko, who I think, correct me if I'm wrong, to Professors McNeilan and Mitchell, this is the first victory of the Innocence Project in Michigan. Is that accurate, or is it?
Of our Innocence
Project. Of the, right.
There was one example.
In Cooley. Whatever order you choose to go.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman and members of the committee. I'm really happy that you have the time to listen to me again. I know most of you have heard me before, so probably not saying anything new. And, of course, you know that I'm here in support of the bill. What I'd like to share with you is some of the real experiences that we've had at our Innocence Project and that we're aware of at other projects throughout the country. What we've learned from working with the sort of work that we do is that a wrongful incarceration is an unimaginable horror that often is compounded when an innocent inmate is released into the changed world. Most of the people that we work with have been in prison for decades. In fact, in Michigan, you don't even fall under the statute unless you were convicted prior to 2001. While incarcerated, most exonerees suffer profound losses. These are not simple losses. They're losses that most of us can't even imagine. Studies done by the Life After Exoneration Project found that 90% or more, in some cases, of exonerees lose every single one of their assets while incarcerated. That's their savings, their vehicles, and their homes. If they're married, many times their spouse's support will divorce them. I mean, they're not going to support them through decades of incarceration. Almost all, if they have children, lose custody of their children and lose total contact with their children. When they're released with nothing. They have no money for living expenses. They have no housing. They have no medical care. They have no medical insurance. They have no employable skills. They have no vocational training, and they have no jobs. I got to tell you, you know, this bill has been introduced numerous times. I can't tell you the horror that we witness when an exoneree gets out. I just recently came back from a conference in Santa Clara, California, where the New York Innocence Project brought in 86 exonerees. I spoke to at least half of those exonerees. The stories that I heard were horrendous about what they're going through to get their lives together. I heard suicide thoughts. I heard depression. I heard inmates who were living in cars. I heard inmates who were living under bridges. This is inexcusable in today's society. One of the things that we've had to deal with at our project is, you know, we're very proud to be doing the kind of work we're able to do, and we're very thrilled that there's been all these technical sort of movements with DNA and ways that we can prove when someone was wrongfully convicted. But you would think that we could just do this work and we could be happy to do it and we could walk these inmates out of prison and feel good about it, but we don't. Before we even bring a petition for an inmate, one of the things we have to do is we have to go talk to the inmate. We ask him numerous questions. Do you have family? Do you have housing when you get out of here? Do you have a place where you'll be able to get food? Are you on any medications? These are not things that we should have to be worried about doing the kind of work we do. One of the recent cases that we have, the man is 56 years old. He's been incarcerated for 25 years. His parents have both died while he was in prison. His son is doing a life sentence. He has no other children. He has a sister only. And we talked to his sister. His sister wants nothing to do with him. She's on assistance herself. She still thinks he's guilty no matter what it shows. He was from a dysfunctional family to begin with. Here's our horror. We get him exonerated. Imagine. We're in the court, the same with our other exonerees. He's unhandcuffed. We walk him out the door. What then? What do I do with this person? Do I just walk away and say, okay, I've done my job. Have a good life. Where's he going to go? Down to the park bench? Under a bridge? We've even talked to shelters that don't want to take these people because they don't fall under the criteria
that the shelter sets itself up for. We're a drug shelter. We're a rehabilitation shelter for CSC cases. We get funding only to shelter certain people. We can't take these individuals. I ask you, how can we not compensate these people? This has been a horrendous thing that has happened to them. And, you know, this is a state law. This is the people of the state of Michigan versus this defendant. I understand that many of you have questions about why is it that the state has to be the one who supports these individuals. Quite honestly, this is not an issue of blame. Somebody has to step up to the plate. The counties oftentimes don't have the money to do it. And across the country, the trend is that states are stepping up and saying, we've got to help these individuals in some way. And then I often hear questions about, well, what's the big deal? Why can't these guys get employment? You know, just like everybody else. Well, first of all, there's a stigma attached to being incarcerated. No matter what you want to say or what you want to do, often people do not believe that these people did not commit this crime or some other crime that caused them to be targeted for the crime they were incarcerated for. Exonerees who disclose their prior conviction to explain why there's this